Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. Each week these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Terrell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor Terrell continues the series entitled, Biblical Truth Concerning the State of Israel. When Israel went into captivity and a remnant returned 70 years later, the 500,000 Jews who chose to stay behind didn't want to leave because they had achieved financial and political success and liked the highly developed Babylonian lifestyle. As a result, only 42,360 men chose to go back to Jerusalem. This parallels the comfortable lives of many Christians who have very little desire to serve the Lord and warn the world of the coming judgment. The last Old Testament prophet Malachi warned that God was no longer interested in land, but wanted to prepare his people for eternity. Likewise, God is not interested in America and its political system, but looking for people who will repent and serve him during the end times. This sobering message is entitled Part 5C, The Prophets. Now, let's go to the sanctuary and join Pastor Terrell as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, March 1st, 2009. Can you believe we finished 2 months of 2009? You only got 10 left to go. Time is flying. And today, we're going to talk about the prophets and of the return from Babylon. Let's stand and pray. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank and praise you right now for the privilege that I'm healed. By your stripes, I was healed. All of us are healed, Lord. I be thankful for that. And Father God, I pray right now for your Holy Spirit. Minister to me today. Minister to each one listening to my voice. That Father God, today would be a fantastic journey through the Bible, Lord, as we will learn your will for our lives. And this we ask now in confidence, knowing that the Holy Spirit is here, ministering to us, speaking to us, guiding us, leading us. And this we ask in Jesus' name. And those who are great said, Amen. You may be seated. Let me say a few things here before I start my message. First of all, I want you to notice that God loves you. Let's settle that this morning. God does love you. He loves me. God loves people. He hates sin. And what we're going to be looking at today is our destiny on this earth. And you want to go beyond our personal feelings. If you look upon the setting right now of Daniel and Israel at that time, actually Judah and Benjamin, we go back 2,500 years. They had faced an invasion. They had been taken captives. There was destruction. The finances were destroyed. Life was simply just one big upheaval. But God had a plan, and this was God's plan, was simply this. He wanted to have a temple built. He wanted Jewish people back in Israel so that eventually he could bring in the Messiah. Now, all the people living at that time are not gone from the earth. They're either in heaven or they're in hell. And it doesn't matter. Matter of fact, we can't even find their houses. Their gold and silver is gone. Their clothing is gone. Everything they have is gone. Doesn't exist anymore. It got tied up some other place or recycled or whatever. And this is what I want you and me to think about today. we are here right now. I got to eat. I got to sleep. I got to have a body. But I'm not here to eat, sleep, have a good time, have a vehicle, have a place to live. I am here with a purpose to make a difference in eternity. I want you to think about this now as we look into this. Daniel now was the last of the four prophets we talked about that God raised up. Daniel was taken to Babylon 11 years prior to the destruction of Jerusalem, along with his three companions. If you read from Daniel 1, 1 through 6. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, to his hand with part of the vessel of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God, and he brought the vessel into the treasure house of his gods. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of the eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed out of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, skillful in all wisdom, cunning in knowledge, understanding signs, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat, and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the time, that at the end thereof, they might stand before the king. Now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Let's look briefly now upon these teenage boys. If you don't know what a eunuch is a man that has been castrated. And the kings, back in those years, they liked to do that with servants. Because if they had a man that was castrated, he would not be married. He would make his full devotion to the king. And thus, these four boys, among others, were selected to be servants of the king of Babylon. And the king of Babylon didn't care if they were married or were married later on, have families and so on. He simply had them castrated. And I discussed it some time before when I talked about the book of Daniel. And if you now think about it as a young man, maybe 18 years old, 17, 19, knowing this, my city is destroyed. I will never be able to have children. I will never be able to be married. And I'm dragged over to this place to serve this very selfish king, and he just ruined my life. I'm sure that Satan told Daniel these words. Why did God allow this to happen to Daniel? Because God simply had a purpose for Daniel. Daniel was not born, and it might be difficult for some of you to understand this, but let me put it out. You think about it, you pray about it. When God created Daniel and designed him in the beginning, before the creation, he never designed Daniel to be a father. He never decided to be a husband. He simply designed him to be a prophet. At a certain time, at a certain place, and Daniel, together with John, the Apostle, Book of Revelation, was to give the church, the world, an understanding of the end times. Now, this has been a sore subject, and I will make a mention of it. My wife and I never had any children. And we wanted to have children. And when people asked us, you know, we were kind of, what do you call it, not shy about it, but we felt, you know, embarrassed. And people came up and said, well, how many children do you have? We don't have any. But what's wrong with you? You know, people can be very insensitive. But I was talking with Charles some time back. And Charles was asking me the question. He said, now, how were you able to do all these different things? You had a Bible study just about every night of the week. You did radio programs. You did a church. You went overseas. You wrote books. You did all these different things. And then he said, I can see now where you don't had any children. So it took me many years. I was probably about in my 50s when I recognized that this is who I am. This is what I got. And I am in God's will. He's given us some beautiful children through my brother Peter, and also a lot of children in churches and so on. But the thing I want you to think about today is this. Don't center on what you think your needs are, your desires, but begin to center on what does God want with my life? What's the purpose? Because he has a tremendous purpose for us. Daniel was elevated to a political office in Babylon. He served as a political advisor to the kings of Babylon until it was conquered 61 years later in 539 BC by King Cyrus of Persia. Now, Daniel served as a political advisor 61 years. That was his job. Daniel was retained as a political advisor for the King Darius and served for a total of 70 years then as a top political leader. Now turn to Daniel chapter 6. Daniel the 6th chapter. And if you pick it up, the first three verses. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which would be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. This is King Darius now. The Persians, they had conquered the Babylonians. And for a conquering king to maintain the main political leader of a defeated kingdom was unheard of. But you see, God had a plan. You and I have been called into these last days. We are coming from different places in the California Valley here, the Sacramento Valley. And some of you are retired. Some of you are thinking about retirement. And I want you to think outside the box today. You know, the normal thing is this, that, you know, you work hard, get to your Social Security, get your retirements, if you got something left. Someone said there are no more 4 OKs, there are 2 OKs. And sometimes it might be down to 1 OK. And then it might be down to 0 OK, because the money disappears. But you see, God did not design you to live a life, have your family, raise them up, and then for you sit at some place and rock away and waste the rest of your life. God does not need any more residents in the convalescent homes. He needed workers there. God does not need any more people that are simply professional recreationists. He needs men and women that can simply say, praise God, I got my Social Security, I got my retirement set, I can serve God full time. If you think about, well, I'm going to go over here and sit over here and I'm going to go over there, you know, and just sit there and rock my chair until Jesus come, why croak? You wasted your life. You want to simply keep occupying until Jesus comes, or he calls you and you drop out. Daniel was used by God as a young man. He was used by God as an older man. The prophet Ezekiel referred to Daniel twice. Turn back to Ezekiel 14:14. Now, Ezekiel and Daniel were contemporaries. They were living at the same time, but Ezekiel was a priest. Daniel was a political leader. In Ezekiel 14:14, we read the following. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, says the Lord God. And then you turn to Ezekiel 28. That's Ezekiel, the 28th chapter. And we look at first three verses here. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, this is the Lord God, because your heart is lifted up. You have said, I am God. I sit at the seat of God in the midst of the seas. Yet you are man and not God. Do you set your heart as the heart of God? Behold, you are wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that they can hide from you. Now, twice here, Ezekiel refers to the prophet Daniel. And then in Daniel chapter 9, Daniel is referring to the prophet Jeremiah. If you read there from 9, the first two verses. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, and the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, stood by books, the number of the years, whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. The book of Daniel is a powerful testimony for the Jewish people of what God can do when his people are obedient and trust in him. God also used Daniel to reveal secrets of the end times. And together with the book of Revelation, Christians have a clear understanding of the end times. Now, if you are interested in it, I preached a number of sermons on Daniel. We got a little booklet. We got recordings of it. It's available. But I want to hit this one thing today on Daniel. He was simple to us. He was living for the purpose of being a prophet to give stability to the Jewish community in Babylon and to make sure that God's will was done. God did not bring you from the place where you came from just to simply have you come here for a little while, get acquainted, and then you take off and go and retire someplace. God is raising up people here of different nationalities that have come and moved to Sacramento. We have people from different parts of the United States, and there are people in the United States right now that maybe in a year or 2 years will also be in Sacramento. You might not know it now, but orders have come for you to move. And so you might as well just get ready to kiss your things goodbye and recognize that God is moving you on. God is raising up a church, a movement to give stability in the end times. As we having all kind of things coming down the pipeline, God is simply saying this, just like he did with Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and Isaiah. He simply prepared people. When there is chaos and destruction, God has prepared a rescue squad. You and I are a rescue squad prepared for the end times. And it's exciting to be part of God's solution, not of the problems. Let me read to you here a summary of the four prophets. God raised up four prophets in Jerusalem to prepare the tribes of Judah and Benjamin to carry the message of the living God for generations to come. They also laid the foundational teaching for the coming Messiah, who would come to the Jewish people some 450 years later. The prophets never promised the Jewish people that God would restore an earthly political kingdom on the earth. Instead, the people were told that there would be a total restoration in the future, an event totally from God and under the leadership of the divine Messiah, not a human political military leader. What God is doing with us now is this. He's preparing us because down the road, it might be 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 40, we don't know. But eventually, the United States will cease to exist as a nation. Get used to that idea. America will cease to exist. Canada will cease to exist. The Bible says that every nation, all nations in this world, will be merged into a world federation. This will be the kingdom of the Antichrist. We're heading down that direction. We don't know how fast it is going. Let me just give you this example here. This is from Gert in Belgium. I was talking about the microchip and smart cards and so on. And Gert told me this. He says, well, you know, don't get too excited. He said, I right now, in Belgium, we have the smart card. We have now a ID card that has a chip in it. Not a strip, but a chip. He says, it doesn't matter where I go. That's all I need. That's my passport. That's my everything. To go to the bank, I use my card. If I go to the dump, they have recycling there. There's a lot of green over there. He said, I simply go down, come to the dump. I put my card in, and a voice says, well, you know, good afternoon, whatever it is, to his name. He goes in. He puts the card back when he goes out, and he said, everything, finances, banking, schools, driving, everything is in one card. I said, Gert, I said, I can go along with that as long as this chip is in the card. When a chip is moved from the card to the body, that's when you and I get off. It's a total paper control in Belgium and in most part of the European Union countries. It's coming here. Now, we are fiercely independent. We are Americans. We feel that we have the right to bear arms and do this and that. Listen, eventually we will lose that. And the reason is that God has prepared and told in advance. Now, the good news is that after this, I don't want to call him an idiot, but he is an idiot, the Antichrist. After he's come here, then we have Jesus coming back. So we might have a little bit bad times coming up, but then we have good times rolling in. So don't get too worried about if you got some bad times. Good times are coming. Let's talk now about the return from Babylon. Turn to Ezra now. Go back to the Old Testament. And Ezra is found before Psalms. Got to go back and find him this morning. He was here yesterday. There he is. Don't hide from me. Turn to Ezra chapter 1. And we can learn a whole lot of things from this teaching here. The return from Babylon. Now the Jewish people had been in Babylon for 70 years. They had prospered. They had become rich, powerful. They moved up. King Cyrus of Persia, who conquered Babylon in 539 BC in the first year of his rule, decreed that the temple of Jerusalem would be rebuilt and that Jews who had been kept in captivity in Babylon were free to go home to Judah. Cyrus died just 9 years later in 530. He only lived for 9 years, actually ruled for 9 years. Here now is a king, Cyrus. God moves upon this man and says, "Now, release my people." The Jews now have been for 70 years. The older one had died off with two new generations. And you would think that they would be excited. "Well, we can go back to Jerusalem. We are free." But as we're going to look upon here, only a small remnant would go. It's important to note that King Cyrus did not restore political freedom to the Jewish people. Judah was still to remain a loyal province to the Persian Empire, but they would have freedom to rebuild the temple and worship the true God. Understand this now. God was not going to restore a physical nation of Israel at this time. He's done with that. He wanted people to come back. He wanted to rebuild the temple because God was working for the Messiah to come. Did the people at that time understand that? Probably not. Let's read now from Ezra chapter 1. "Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put also in writing, saying," let's back up now. Look at this. "That the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus." I don't care if we got a president of the United States today that is ungodly, doing this or not. It makes no difference. God has a plan. God is moving. And God is going to have his way. "Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven has given me all the kingdoms of the earth. He has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah." Cyrus now, a man, a Gentile, not a believer in God per se, God came to him and said, "Cyrus, make sure that my temple is rebuilt." when we saw the Soviet Union fall apart, 90, 91, you know, I lived for many years under the, in the Cold War, and people says, well, you know, the communists will never let go of Russia. They will never do it. And you know, in less than 12 months, the Soviet Union crumbled. Most of us lived through it, but all of us lived through it. We saw it happen. Why? Because for years and years and years, Christians in Russia, the Ukrainians, they prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and God said, yeah, 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 I heard it. It's coming, and when it comes, it goes fast. Who is there among you of all these people? He's got to be with him. Let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is a God which is in Jerusalem. And whosoever remains in any place where he sojourns, let the men of his place help him with silver and with gold and with goods and with beasts beside the freewill offering for the house of God that is in Jerusalem. Look in verse 3. Who is there among you of all these people? He's got to be with him. And let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. We have been commissioned not to build an earthly building. But you see, the temple of God today is made up of people, his people. I'm a stone in the temple of God. Your stones together, you make up the temple of God. God has commissioned us. He's called you from different places. And he's simply saying this, I have caused you to come here because I am going to do a work through you in these last days. And some of you might be on the sleepy side, and some of you might just be thinking, well, you know, who am I, and so on. You are a light bulb. All that needs to be done is for you to be screwed into the socket, someone turn on the power, and all the power of God can flow through you. You see, it doesn't matter how much education you got, how much intelligence you got, to what you this and that. You understand that God, in less than 10 seconds, can have the resurrection power moving through your body and totally reshape you, refurbish you, and equip you with things that you were not even able to think was possible. The problem is unbelief, unbelief, unbelief. Another thing is that over the years, you have been defeated over and over again, and you can't get over that you can be victorious. Verse 5. Then rose up the chief of the fathers of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and the Levites with all them whose spirit God had raised. Notice now, who got stirred? Those whose spirit God had raised to go up to build the house of the Lord, which is in Jerusalem. And all they were about them strengthened their hands with vessels of silver, with gold, with goods, with beasts, and with precious things, beside all that was willingly offered. Also Cyrus the king brought forth the vessels of the house of the Lord, which Nebuchadnezzar had brought forth of Jerusalem, had put them in the house of his gods. Even those did Cyrus, king of Persia, bring forth by the hand of Mithridath, the treasurer, and numbered them unto Sheshbazzar, the prince of Judah. And then they list here how much they carried with them and what they got. God not simply said, it's time to go, time to build, and time to obey and to do what God has spoken. Look at this now. I'm on page 2 now. Only a small remnant of the descendants of Judah and Benjamin left Babylon, a total of 42,360 persons. If you read Ezra 2:1. Now these are the children of the prophets that went up of captivity, of those which had been carried away, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, carried away into Babylon, and came again into Jerusalem, and Judah, every one unto his city. And then turn to verse number 64. The whole congregation together was 42,303, besides their servants and their maids, of whom there were 7,337. And there were among them 200 singing men and singing women. I want you to see verse 65. God had a choir of 200 men and women. What is our strength? The strength is the joy of the Lord. The strength is the joy of the Lord. Realize this now. In this revival movement, in this awakening that we are part of, we're going to have music, testimonies, prayer, preaching. God is raising up singers and musicians to be part of this. They are coming. We are the vanguard. Matter of fact, today is exactly 3 years ago that we took possession of these facilities. For 3 years, we've been sitting here, puttering, on a back burner, maintaining, growing personally, building this and that. God's been building a foundation. And now he's simply saying, I'm going to move you to the front burner. God is doing a great work in you and in me. And then we read, their horses were 736, their mules 245, and so on. And then we go down here to verse number 69. They gave after their ability unto the treasure of the work 61,000 drams of gold, 5,000 pounds of silver, and 100 priest garments. If you read those verses, who gave that? Jewish people? Tribes of Judah? Benjamin? Where were they? 70 years prior, they had come out of Jerusalem, slaves, walking away to Babylon as slaves. 70 years later, their descendants and some of the old ones came back. They had so much gold and horses and everything else, they couldn't carry it all. When God calls, God equips, God finances, he does it all. But you see, now for you and me, it's that unbelief. Well, you know, I'm just a little guy over here, you know. I don't know about this and that. Let me ask you this question. I want you to think deeply right now. We all think highly of Abraham Lincoln. Of course, he had problems. But let's say that somebody would come up. If you and I would go back, if I would have a travel machine here, and I would simply dial in, you know, about 1837. We step in, you know, we're back there, you know. And we go down now to this little hamlet, the village, whatever it is. And here's a teenager, Abraham Lincoln. I might be off of my years. And, you know, we just say, hey, Abe, come here. This lanky teen's come over and says, yeah, what? Do you know that you're going to be the president of the United States? What? What are you guys talking about? I'm nothing. I'm a nobody. Do you understand that every man and woman that God has used on this earth never could dream where they're going to end up? That's the beauty of it. Because if you and I knew exactly where we're going to end up before we leave this earth, you know what you and I would do? We would beeline right down to that place right now and bypass all the classes God wants you to take. There are classes: obedience, faith, patience, persistence. God brought them back. Let me read now from my outline. The majority of the Jews remained in Babylon because they were comfortable with their lifestyle. 530 years later, during the time of Christ, the Jewish population in Babylon was estimated to have grown to 1 million during the years of 200 to 500 AD, there were more than 2 million Jews living in Babylon. This should explain why the Apostle Peter left Jerusalem and took up residence in Babylon for a season and established a strong Christian church made up of Babylonian Jews. Now turn to 1 Peter 5. Some of you have never heard about this before, because you thought, you know, that Peter always went straight to Rome. He went to Rome when he was in his last days. He died in Rome. 1 Peter chapter 5, if you pick it up in verse number 13. The church that is at Babylon, elected together with you, salutes you, and so does Marcus, my son. Greet you one another with a kiss of charity or love. Peace be with you all that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. Peter was ministering, set up a church in Babylon. What can you and I learn about this now? Well, some of you got spouses that are not going too fast. Some of you got spouses that are stuck someplace with a big chain around their neck. Some of you, you know, got all kind of different problems. You simply says, now, well, what's going to happen to me? All God needs is for you to say, God, I am available. You use me as you see fit. All you have to do is to say, I'm available. God will take care of the rest. He has a very wonderful method of moving people around and also to making people understand what they need to do if they do not want to do it. God can park somebody for a while and speak to them. We had difficulties now in Jerusalem. We move on there. In 445 B.C., when Artaxerxes was king of the Persian Empire, the Jews in Jerusalem were having a hard time. They had run out of money. Does that sound familiar to our church? You know, we've been on a string budget for a long time, and then God sends something in. I want you to see this now. God was excited. Cyrus, move them out. Head them up. Some of you know, little thing what I'm talking about. So they got out. But 94 years later, the temple was still not finished, the city was in shambles, and nothing was moving. Does that mean that God was not working there? No. God takes his sweet time. The Jews had a hard time. They had come back 94 years earlier, but because of political intrigue, we know what that is, the rebuilding program of Jerusalem, the temple had come to a standstill. This news was brought to the attention of Nehemiah, who was a cupbearer for Artaxerxes. Now turn to Nehemiah chapter 1. He's also hiding in the Old Testament. He's close to Ezra. If you found Ezra, you will find Nehemiah. And there he is. I knew I took him with me to church. Nehemiah chapter 1. When God needs something, he puts a burden on people. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, and it came to pass in the month Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left in the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burnt with fire. Today, if you look at America, the church has been destroyed. The mighty Southern Baptist Convention used to be 25 million strong, solid, Bible-believing people have been taken over, hijacked by Rick Warren, the purpose-driven life, and they are in shambles, in New Age. There's a few Southern Baptist churches here and there, but the majority of them have gone to, not to the dogs, but they've gone to some kind of a bad hole. All right? Now, call up your Methodists. If you call up the Methodists, you will find that the Methodists of today have no resemblance to the Methodists 100 years ago. The Methodists today are like spaghetti that's been overboard, just hanging there, flopping back and forth. They don't know which way they're going to go. Call up the Presbyterians, and they are gone. Call up the Salvation Army. It's a social outfit. You call up all these strong churches that we had of the past, and they are gone. Remnants here and there. Look what happened to the charismatic movement. They got all insane. They got into insanity and run off. And you know what is the latest craze in the charismatic circles, Pentecostals now, is to talk to the dead. And here's how they got that theology going there. They simply said this, that when Jesus was going to go to be crucified, God brought back Moses and Elijah to speak to him on the mountain of transfiguration. Therefore, we cannot call up some of the old leaders. We have Amy McPherson has been called up. Spirit comes up and says, "Oh, I'm Amy." And they're asking her, you know, "Can I, what do we do?" They're calling up dead Pentecostal leaders of the past. That's the latest craze in the charismatic movement. They used to call that seances, which was done by people in the occult. How much do you have left in the United States or in Canada or in Europe? Little, burned, destroyed. And you see, that's when God will begin to move. When somebody gets concerned. Look now to verse number 4. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept, and mourned certain days, and fasted, and prayed before the God of heaven, and said, I beseech you, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that keeps covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Nehemiah said, God, I don't like this. I want to make a change. I can call up, you take the Greek Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, you take just about every old denomination. They have gone out of the way. You know, I saw this and I kind of wept. I can't understand this. Now, we have a wonderful State Department. You got to hand it to Hillary, you know. She's running a wonderful organization. They had discovered that there's a lot of violence in Mexico. So they've issued a travel warning. And simply saying this to American teenagers, that if you're going to go and drink, fornicate, run around, and have a mess, please don't go to Mexico. You might get killed there. But go with your fornication, drinking, and everything else over here where it's safe. Isn't that a wonderful State Department? It's called Safe Sex. Safe drinking. And I saw some clips, beaches, and you saw hundreds and hundreds of young women wearing nothing but skimpy little things around their bodies, men, beers, booze. And also they said, well, you know, if they go to Mexico, the drinking age is lower, that they can drink when they are younger. And I thought about, isn't there anyone in America that simply will say it is not acceptable to send young children, 16, 17, 18, 19 years old, to go and fornicate and drink themselves to oblivion and say, now that's spring break. We need to ask them to give us a break. That's how our nation is. What should we do then? Well, let's see what Nehemiah did. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted. He grieved. He fasted. He prayed before the God of heaven and said, I beseech you, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keeps covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let your ear now be attentive and your eyes open, that you may hear the prayer of your servants, which I pray before you now, day and night, for the children of Israel you served and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against you. Both I and my father's house have sinned. This is revival prayer. Maybe 2 months ago, 3 months ago, God told me to start having you come up here to pray. And first I felt silly. I simply said, well, you know, what do we do? Then God said, that's what I want you to do. And we hear answer the prayers every week. God answering prayers. Now, if I can get you out of your unbelief, and out of your pain and agony. Now I know this. I believe that God allowed it to happen. Monday and Tuesday, I could not pray. My mind was foggy. I had poison in my body. I couldn't pray. I just moaned and groaned. But somebody else was praying for me. And you and I need to begin to pray for this nation. How many girls do you think are going to come back from Florida, Mexico, and other places pregnant after the spring break? I would say thousands. And you know what will happen to them next? An abortion. They might be in their late teens, early 20s. But you know what? That murder will never get away from them. And from that moment, from that time on now, they will simply regret and say, I fornicated. I gave my body away to some jerk that don't even love me. I don't even know him. And I killed my child. It's a regret. Can we change that? We can if we pray. I want to read this verse again, verse number 6. Let your ear now be attentive and your eyes open, that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now, day and night, for the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we, Nehemiah said, I part of this, and we as a church, we have sinned against you. Both I and my father's house, we have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against you, have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgment which you command your servant Moses. Remember, I beseech you, the word you command your servant Moses, saying, if you transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if you turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though they were of you cast out in the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place I've chosen to set my name there. He's saying, God, forgive us. Now these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by the great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I beseech you, let now your heart be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name and prosper, I pray you, your servant in this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. For I was the king's cupbearer. Notice now, Nehemiah is not saying, oh God, I need more. I need another house. I need another car. I need this. I need that. I need more comfort. He says, God, we need you to move in our nation. And that's where you and I need to be. We need to pray. God, move in America. God, move in Canada. God, move in Europe. God, move in Asia. God, move everywhere. Nehemiah's job was to make sure that the king was not poisoned. So before the king would eat or drink, the cupbearer would first taste it to make sure there was no poison present. This was an important position, and the cupbearer would yield certain political powers. When the king Artaxerxes found out why Nehemiah was grieved, he commissioned Nehemiah to travel to Jerusalem and to take control over Jerusalem. Chapter 2, and we read a few verses here. And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it to the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said to me, why is your countenance sad, seeing you are not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid. You know, this is one thing that you and I do not have. We don't have sorrow of heart yet over our nation. We still haven't come to the place that when we see on our news programs the young people being destroyed, we don't weep. For some reason, we become cold and hard. And he says, oh, well, you know, that's all going this way. They're going to hell anyway, so who cares? We need to ask God. God, take our hearts of stone. Move them out and give us a heart of flesh. That we will have compassion and to pray and to seek the Lord. And said to the king, that the king live forever? Why should not my captain be sad? When the city, the place of my father's sepulchres lies waste, and the gates of our consumed with fire. Then the king said to me, for what does you make requests? So I prayed to the God of heaven. Now, the king said, okay, what do you want? Nehemiah prayed a quick prayer, God, what do I tell the king? And I said to the king, if you please the king, and if your servant have found favor in your sight, that you would send me unto Judah, unto the city of my fathers, sepulchres, that I may build it. Are you willing to pray that prayer? My heavenly Father in heaven, please use me in these last days to rebuild this kingdom, this earth on earth. The people are destroyed. Help me to go out and rescue them, one by one, person by person. And the king said to me, the queen was sitting by him, for how long shall your journey be, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Nehemiah had a concern. He wanted to rebuild Jerusalem, organize the situation there. You know what? I want you to catch this now. Nehemiah prepared the road for Jesus that came 430 years later. You and I have been called to prepare for Jesus. We got the Antichrist coming, but we got Jesus coming after him. And God is simply saying this, who will go for me? Who will prepare? Who will go out there and rescue souls and do something in the last days? So when Jesus comes, we can have a crowd around us saying, praise the Lord Jesus, I got a harvest for you. It's not a time to come out and say, well, you know, I set it out in a rocking chair in a retirement home. I was sitting over here, you know, just puttering around in my garden. God couldn't care less about that. He needs men and women today that are simply saying this, I'm going to roll up my sleeves, I'm going to go to work, and I'm going to begin to pray and fast because something needs to be done. If we can agree on that, we are exploding in power. 13 years later, a small temple was finished and the walls of Jerusalem had been rebuilt. Turn to Nehemiah chapter 7. Nehemiah, the 7th chapter, we read the first 2 verses. Now it came to pass, when the wall was built, and I had set up the doors and the ports and the singers, and the Levites were appointed, that I gave my brother Hanani and Hananiah, the ruler of the palace, charge of Jerusalem, for he was a faithful man and feared God above many. Now, and then if you turn to chapter 8. If you read a few verses here. Let me private in verse 6. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. And all the people answered, Amen, Amen, with lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Verse 8. So they read in the book in the law of God distinctly and gave the sentence and caused them to stand at reading. And Nehemiah, which is a Tirshatha, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites, they taught the people, said to all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep, for all the people wept when he heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, go your way, eat the fat and drink the sweet, and send portions to them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be you sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. God is saying now, as we have repented, as we seek him, the joy of the Lord is our strength. So the Levites stilled all. The people saying, hold your peace, for the day is holy. Neither be you grieved. We grieve, we pray, God answers, and then we can begin to rejoice. I'm not only calling you that are here today. You pretty much made up your mind what you're going to do for the Lord. But I'm calling people that are either watching us right now or later or hearing us. And I'm saying this, God is raising you up. Some of you are going to be raised up in a city, an area where you live. He's going to use you there. But it's going to be a movement that God is creating right here in the midst of us. Let me talk to you about the last prophet before Jesus. And you want to turn to Matthew chapter 3. Matthew, the third chapter. Matthew chapter 3. And let me read from the outline. The last prophet before Jesus. The last prophet God sent to the Jewish people was Malachi, which in Hebrew means messenger. He did not reveal his true name, so we do not know who he was. The date that his prophecy is set by Bible is going to be around 432 B.C. It would be some 400 years before God again spoke to the Jewish people through a prophet whose name was John the Baptist. Matthew 3:1. In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and say, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair, a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locust and wild honey. And then went out to him Jerusalem, and all Judea, and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees said to come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come, bring forth therefore fruits made for repentance. Verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water to repentance. But he that comes after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he will burn up chaff with unquenchable fire. John the Baptist was a prophet to prepare for Jesus. And turn to Malachi. Malachi chapter 3. You find him just before Matthew. Malachi. And we turn to the third chapter. This is the last major prophet. After this, God was silent for 400 years. Behold, I will send messengers, and he shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even a messenger of the covenant whom you delight in. Behold, it shall come, says the Lord of hosts. But who may abide the day of his coming? Who shall stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire. We sang that this morning, like the fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi, and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the days of old, and is as in the former years. Malachi gave the Jewish people instructions about what to do in a current situation and what would happen to them in the future. It was a clear message that the coming Messiah would not reign as an earthly Jewish king, but as God himself. I'll let you read Malachi 3, 1 through 8 in yourself. We're going to turn to Malachi chapter 4 and read his 6 verses. For behold, the day comes that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble, and the day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts. That shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and you shall go forth and grip as calves of the stall. And you should tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes of your soles and your feet in the day that I shall do this, says the Lord of hosts. Remember you the law of Moses, my servant, which I command to him in Horeb for all Israel, with all statute and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah. That was John the Baptist, the prophet, before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of your father to the children, and the heart of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Let me give you the call to the stand now. This is what God has called you and me to do. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. God has called you and me to go out into the highways and byways, to pool our resources with the webcast we have now and other things. And he's done that with a purpose, to have people be saved and receive eternal life. I want to close with this illustration. I remember vividly, and I will never forget it, 1966. I was working in the little city of American Fork in Utah for the highway department. And I was going home for lunch. I only lived about 5 minutes away from my work. And when I came home, my wife said, you know, we got an audio cassette today from Sweden. And she said, can we hear that? And I said, yes. It was from her uncle. Her uncle had been a Christian for many years, be praying for us later on and so on. And I remember I had prepared a lunch. You always have good lunch, good food for me. And I sat down there. And we had a little tape recorder in those days. It was set on a table and began to play it. And I did not know that that was a day that God would call me. As I was sitting and eating, I heard this man. There was a former opera singer in Sweden give his testimony at something like a full gospel businessman's dinner someplace in Sweden, a restaurant. You could hear the glasses. You could hear the talking behind as he was speaking. And as he spoke, and I heard the glasses, and I heard the noise from the restaurant, I heard his voice, suddenly I was shut out from the world. And I heard a voice inside of me saying, John, I am calling you into this ministry. And when I heard that voice, I never finished my lunch. I just started to cry, tears just gushing out. And in those days, I would not show my wife I could cry. I just took the napkin. I just put in my face, and I got to run to the bathroom. And I got into the bathroom, locked the door, didn't want her to come back after me. I turned on every faucet you had in there, flushed everything. And I stood in and I sobbed. And I said, God, God, you're calling me. And I said, yes. Yes, Lord. I will go. It took me 4 months after that. I didn't know what to do. I knew I had a calling. I talked to my pastor. Said, well, Pastor, I think I'm called to the ministry. He said, that's fine. Just kept on going. Every week I bugged him and said, what do I do, Pastor? I'm called to the ministry. He said, that's fine, John. It's fine. And then finally, April the 16th, 1967, at the 11 o'clock worship service, I was like a coiled spring. And when he has finished his sermon and gave the invitation, I jumped out of my seat. I ran down and said, Pastor, God has called me to the ministry, and you better hear it. He says, praise God. And he said, I receive you. Afterward, I said to him, now, why do you keep me off? He said, I want to make sure that God called you, not your emotions. He said, a road you will have will be a tough road. A road of tears, heartaches, resistance. Unless you know you are called, you won't last. And 37 years later, I can say this. If I did not know that I know that I know that God called me, I wouldn't have lasted. Today, God is calling you. He's calling you for different things. He's calling you watching me right now. He's calling you watching later. Listen to us. And God is simply saying this. And I'll read it again. And he said, turn the heart of the father to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest they come and smite the earth with a curse. Are you willing to be called today to say, I might not be a pastor, I might not be a missionary, but I want to be part of this move of God? Because you see, when you go to the service station, you have a mission field there. When you go to the store, you got a mission field there. Wherever you go, there are people. Don't wait for a preacher to come. You take care of them when you meet them. That's what God is calling us for. I know this, that if you say yes, there'll be a move of God in you that you can never explain. Don't wait for your spouse. Don't wait for your brother or sister. Don't wait for anyone else. Simply saying, God, I understand. I want to be part. I want to be part of a move of God in these last days. That when I go to be with Jesus, I can have a busload behind me of men and women that I can say, I brought them to the Master. I'm finished now. The Holy Spirit is here. Some of you already working hard in the kingdom of God. Some of you need to rededicate your lives. Some of you need to make a new commitment. On my right side is a couch and some chairs. If there's not enough, you got chairs at the front. What if I call you out? Because you see, there's something about when you have a call, you make a commitment, you make a move. You can go down and pray and no one will minister to you there. The elders will be up here. If you want someone to talk with you and anoint you with oil and pray with you, might be you have sickness, it might be something else that you have a need of. It's your time to go. It's your time to pray. Now, it's up to you and the Holy Spirit. Let me say one last thing. Because that lunch hour, I said yes. 37 years later, 36 years later, in a restaurant here in town, I met the man, 92 years old, he could have been my grandfather. And that man had lived a long life, and I led him to Christ right there. It's one of the ones in my busload that I'm taking with me. There are people out there right now that are waiting for you. They're waiting for you. God has earmarked you to be the one that leads them to Christ. But before you can do that, you need to surrender. Let's stand and pray. Let's have the team come up here, be ready. My Heavenly Father, God, I want to thank you that you called me 1966. And I thank you, my Heavenly Father, that you gave me the gift of repentance for the privilege of having served you these years. And today, Father God, you're calling men and women, boys and girls, all around the world, at these precious moments. There are young people watching me right now. Tears are going down their eyes right now. And you're speaking to that boy, you're speaking to that girl. And I pray, Holy Spirit, solidify the call in them and help them to make a commitment that they can be that man and woman of God you want them to be. I pray for people here, Lord. Some of them have got a little bit hard over the years and cold, callous, Father God. And I pray today for recommitments. I pray you would call out to this congregation today that we would see some men and women that are willing to say, I'm going to stand in these last days. Count me in, God. Lord, give us a harvest. And let it begin today. And let this harvest begin to roll and roll and roll, day after day, that when it's done, we will see 1 billion people born again, washed in the blood, ready to go to heaven, and praising you with our voices, so we can weep of joy and love you, Lord. And this is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. You come as God's been speaking to you.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just 1 commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Terrell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to Pastor John S. Terrell of Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. This message was the fifth part in the series, Biblical Truth Concerning the State of Israel, and was entitled, The Prophets. When Israel went into captivity and a remnant returned 70 years later, the 500,000 Jews who chose to stay behind didn't want to leave because they had achieved financial and political success and liked the highly developed Babylonian lifestyle. As a result, only 42,360 men chose to go back to Jerusalem. This parallels the comfortable lives of many Christians who have very little desire to serve the Lord and warn the world of the coming judgment. The last Old Testament prophet Malachi warned that God was no longer interested in land, but wanted to prepare His people for eternity. Likewise, God is not interested in America and its political system, but looking for people who repent and serve Him during the end times. This sobering message should bring every believer to their knees in repentance before it's too late. It is available on cassette, CD, and DVD. And when ordering, ask for sermon number 1175. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Terrell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California 95681. If you prefer to call us, the toll-free number in the United States is 1-888-708-3232. That's 1-888-708-3232. For calls from outside the U.S., the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.